Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee in 2021. Agenda item 1 is decision on taking business in private. I'm going to assume that everyone agrees unless a member indicates otherwise. So does any member object to taking items 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9 in private this morning? Please say if you do. Okay, I will take that as agreement on those items. Thank you very much. Agenda item 2 is the Section 22 report on the 2018-19 audit of Bord na Gaeilge, governance and transparency. And I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting this morning, Paul Johnson, Director General, Education, Communities and Justice, and Graham Logan, Director of Learning, both from the Scottish Government. And I understand that Paul Johnson would like to make a brief opening statement. Paul.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for this opportunity to update the committee on the progress that has been made since the evidence session on the 24th September 2020 in relation to the 18-19 audit of Bord na Gaeilge. Bord na Gaeilge has faced challenges in its governance and operations over a number of years, and the 18-19 audit focused on the need for significant improvement within the organisation. There was clear evidence of that improvement set out in the 2019-20 audit, and I have seen the determination shown by the Chair and Chief Executive of Bord na Gaeilge to pursue a wide-ranging improvement programme. And they are the first to recognise that a continued focus on sustaining that improvement is vital. I understand that you will hear directly today from Bord na Gaeilge's auditors, and I hope that they will confirm that they recognise this improving situation. The 18-19 audit recommended that work be done to clarify roles and responsibilities between the sponsor team and Bord na Gaeilge. An internal review of the sponsorship function was completed in September 2020. That recommended greater clarity in terms of the purpose and frequency of engagement between the Scottish Government team and the board, and clarity on matters such as attendance at board meetings and scrutiny of performance. These issues have now been addressed in the updated framework agreement that I sent to the committee on the 26th of February and that is included in the papers for today's meeting. I'm joined today by Graham Logan, who assumed the role of Director of Learning in the Scottish Government in summer 2019. As the Portfolio Accountable Officer for the Education Portfolio, I formally delegate to Graham the responsibility for the oversight of the sponsorship relationship. He and the Deputy Director work closely with the sponsor team. The responsibility of all parties, together with arrangements for regular engagement, are set out clearly in the framework agreement. Alongside any system of delegation, it is vital to have an effective system of escalation. The issues identified in relation to the 18-19 audit of Bord na Gaeilge were escalated to me. They have been considered as part of the Director General audit and assurance arrangements, alongside other sponsorship issues that the committee will consider later this morning. They have also been highlighted as part of the annual certificate of assurance process, and there will be continued focus on improvement with input from the Scottish Government's internal auditors and non-executive directors. In addition to addressing immediate issues, we must share learning from every audit. An event in December 2020 was held for sponsor leads across the Scottish Government, at which we shared key learning points from this 18-19 audit. I held a meeting last week with the Chair and Chief Executive of Bord na Gaeilge and the Director, Deputy Director and sponsor team in the Scottish Government to take stock of progress and ensure clarity as to purpose and direction. I saw evidence of a shared commitment to work closely together with a view to supporting the promotion of Gaelic language and culture in Scotland. Graham and I will be happy to discuss the ways in which we will work to ensure continued improvement in both relationships and performance in the days ahead. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul Johnson. I'm going to ask Colin Beattie to open questioning for the committee, please.
Thank you, Mina. Paul Johnson, thank you for the letter, which clearly outlined the sponsor unit responsibilities and so forth. That's helpful. Can I ask just some basic questions? The person who was responsible for discharging the sponsorship responsibilities, were they a Gaelic speaker?
Yes, the head of the sponsor team is a Gaelic speaker, and members of the team are also speakers of the Gaelic language.
So there was no barrier as far as that was concerned?
No.
In terms of understanding what was happening within the board?
There was no issues there.
You, just looking at this here, you've obviously, since the Section 22, there's obviously been a review of responsibilities in terms of the relationship between the sponsor unit and the Board na Gaelic. Now, surely there is a standard process, a standard level of engagement that was in place previously. Why was it necessary then to revisit this and review what was happening here? Were there deficiencies?
Well, good practice would tell us that all framework agreements between the Scottish Government sponsor teams and public bodies should be kept under regular review. The 2018-19 audit that this committee has considered carefully also emphasised the need for further consideration to be given to the sponsor relationship. As such, I think it was important that we did review that. And we sought the support of some other experienced colleagues within the Scottish Government who were sponsoring other teams to come along to look at what our procedures and policies and relationships were like. And it was as a result of that exercise that in late September 2020, they gave us some recommendations, among which were some suggested improvements for the framework document. And so what I shared with the committee in February is an updated version. There has been a framework document in existence, but there are a number of key clarifications and improvements set out in that most recent document.
So are we saying that the arrangements for each unit that's being sponsored, or each organisation which has a sponsor attached to it, is different? There's not one common document?
Yeah, there is a model framework document that Public Bodies Unit in the Scottish Government has and keeps up to date. And in the later session, we'll be joined by Katrina McLean, who is responsible for that unit. So we share the model document with all sponsor teams, but sponsor teams then need to look at the specific statutory arrangements for the body. You'll appreciate they differ from body to body, and ensure that the particular framework document is quite specific about the roles and responsibilities, which may vary depending on the powers, the duties, the statutory setup of the body in question.
Coming back again to specifics with the board, you stated that the Scottish Government became aware of issues with this organisation in early 2018. How did that physically happen? How was it raised? How was the problem uncovered?
So I would acknowledge, as I sought to acknowledge in my opening statement, it's a matter of public record that there have been challenges with Board na Gaelic for a number of years, and indeed there have been a number of chairs and chief executives, as was mentioned at the September evidence session of the committee. The particular issues that gave rise to the 2018-19 audit by Deloitte were the ones that I have focused on in my letter to the committee in November 2020. And as you can see from the documentation that I submitted, the first formal indication that we saw of the first formal notification was the letter to the deputy director at the time, dated 20th of June 2018. Now, my understanding from speaking to the sponsor team is it was known through discussions that there were some issues in terms of engagement between Bord na Gael and other organisations, but the formal concerns were raised with us in June 2018.
Now, you said that there'd been a history that you were aware of problems with the board, turnover of the directors and so on, chief executive. Would you not have had the board under special, some sort of special scrutiny?
So there was engagement between the Scottish Government and the board throughout its history. And indeed, the Scottish Government has had responsibility for the appointment of the chairs and for the scrutiny of the performance of the chairs. And of course, one of my reflections is whether there needed to be earlier intervention. And I can see why the committee would conclude that there should have been earlier intervention. And that, I think, is one of the key areas of learning from the work that's been done over recent times.
But, you know, frankly, somebody who's carrying out the sponsorship responsibilities should surely have been close enough to the board to be aware of the difficulties that they were having, about the concerns that there were internally. But nothing happened. Apparently nothing was reported back to indicate anything serious.
Well, I wouldn't say nothing happened. That wouldn't be an accurate description. And as you can see from the documentation, when concerns were raised in 2018, and that's you know, well before the audit was received, you can see from the correspondence that the deputy director was active in working with the chair to support Bord na Gael in resolving the issues. And it is important, I think, to emphasise that when bodies such as Bord na Gael and other NDPBs are established, it is primarily their responsibility in terms of the governing legislation and the accountable officer framework to ensure that they're operating effectively and they are audited annually. Nonetheless, there is a responsibility for the Scottish Government, and what you can see happened is the work with the chair and ultimately the appointment of an external person to engage with staff with a view to resolving the issues that had been raised.
So was the person discharging the duty of sponsorship, did they give advice, support, any help to the board at any point?
Yes, the sponsor team and the deputy director have been active in seeking to provide advice and support to the board and to the chief executive.
And was that prior to June 2018?
Yes, there has been engagement throughout the life of the body with the Scottish Government sponsor team and Bord na Gael. And I think it is important to recognise that over the years, while there have been issues, we can also point to some real successes in terms of the work of Bord na Gael in supporting the rollout of Gaelic language plans, in supporting the promotion of Gaelic language and culture in Scotland. And that has been a result of the work of the board and of its staff. And there has been engagement between the Scottish Government and the board through the years. But I'm here today recognising that there have also been issues, and there is important learning from the audit and from the scrutiny of this committee, and we must ensure real clarity around roles and responsibilities, and we must ensure early escalation and resolution of any issues that arise.
I think you'll understand that there's some concern, certainly on my part and probably with the others in the committee, as to at what point really the Scottish Government or the sponsor unit was aware of the seriousness of the problems there and intervened in such a way that hopefully they were put back on track. Now, clearly that did not happen prior to 2018. There is no evidence that it happened prior to 2018. So it's after it became generally known that this support and help has been given. Would you agree?
I would have to emphasise that over the lifetime of the body, we're referring here to a body that was formally established following the passage of the Gaelic Language Act in 2005. And of course, with any body that exists, there will at times be issues that arise. And I think you'll see that audit reports over the years did not raise anything like the issues that were surfaced in the 18-19 audit. So I would say that, as with most sponsor teams, there is an ongoing relationship between the sponsor body and the sponsor team, and most issues are resolved satisfactorily. I think what we saw in 2018 was an escalation of those issues, leading to the course of correspondence that I shared with the committee following my evidence session in September.
Just one last point. What advice was given to ministers at this time?
Well, again, I have sought to set out the advice that we provided to ministers in the documentation that I shared with the committee on the 6th of November 2020. So in the first instance, we ensured that ministers were kept up to date with the way in which we were seeking to support the board in handling the complaints. And we also ensured that ministers were aware of the findings that were emerging from the 2018-19 audit. You'll see then from the correspondence that ministers wrote to the board, emphasising the need for the board to focus on a very clear plan of improvement. I was also asked by ministers, as the portfolio accountable officer, to visit Bord na Gaelic and ensure that I was satisfied that that plan of improvement was being pursued. And I've shared the correspondence from both the Deputy First Minister with Bord na Gaelic and the correspondence that I sent to Bord na Gaelic at the time.
Now, again, this seems to be post-2018, or at least post it becoming evident in 2018. Was there any briefing or advice given to Scottish ministers prior to that?
Undoubtedly, the committee asked me for the correspondence with Bord na Gaelic relating to the issues that we were discussing at the September session. But yes, there will have been advice given to ministers from the sponsor team over the years of the life of this body.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Paul Johnston, what was that advice that was given between early 2018 and June 2018?
So from early 2018, primarily we were advising ministers of the fact of the complaints and concerns that had been raised with us, and advising them of the approach that we were proposing to take on receipt of these concerns. So again, I've disclosed in my letter and the attachments a number of pieces of advice that we sent to ministers. First and foremost, that was assuring them that we were seeking advice on handling from other areas within the Scottish Government, including HR, and that our approach was to ask the chair to lead in handling the issues, since they related to the internal management of Bord na Gaelic, but that we had also asked the chair to ensure there was independent involvement in the resolution of the issues, hence the appointment of an independent person to work with the chair. They then spoke to a number of staff in Bord na Gaelic and came up with recommendations for improvement. So all of those steps were, we advised ministers of all of those steps.
And were ministers satisfied with that?
Yes, ministers indicated that they were content with what we were, with the steps that we were taking.
And there was never a sort of direct intervention by a minister to say, what's actually going on here, or are we doing enough to sort this out?
Well, certainly there was there were discussions with ministers, and I think you can see from the correspondence there was action was taken at quite significant pace, really, once these concerns were brought to our attention, with the full knowledge of ministers. Now, the resolution, as these matters were being resolved, it was really around that time that the wider audit done by Deloitte began. And so the concerns really quite swiftly were in some ways wrapped up in these wider issues that were captured in the audit that the committee has considered. And as I've said, you can see that ministers were proactive in making clear the need for swift resolution of the issues that had been raised through the audit.
The thing is, though, Paul Johnson, if the sponsorship arrangement was working correctly, how did the board be allowed to get to this point?
Well, unfortunately, you know, I wish it was the case that we didn't have issues arising around relationships between particular bodies and stakeholders. But these issues do arise, and the committee will be well aware of that. And they were brought to our attention formally in June 2018 in terms of this correspondence, and we sought to address them. Now, you know, should they have been addressed more speedily? I can absolutely accept, as we look back on this, that we would much prefer that the issues had been nipped in the bud, addressed more rapidly, and there's, as I would acknowledge, there is learning for us there around the rapid escalation and resolution of issues wherever possible. That is part of the learning from this particular audit that we are seeking to emphasise in the wider training that we are providing to other bodies, other sponsor teams.
I mean, we're coming on, as you know, to a session after this one on the general issue of sponsorship, but it just strikes me as, I don't know, if I was a civil servant, had responsibility for a body like this, I think I'd want to check in with them every fortnight or something to check everything was okay and keep some sort of, at least sort of light-handed oversight on it. But to get to this stage, it's clear that that just didn't happen.
Well, there was, as I've said, there was that engagement. But what I can be clear about is that I recognise the need for real clarity and close engagement with Bord na Gaelic going forward. And it may be that Graham Logan could come in just to describe his role and what that will look like in terms of the close engagement between him and his team going forward, if that would be acceptable.
Let's come on to the going forward in a minute, because you know, with respect, Paul Johnson, our role is to look backwards a lot of the time and scrutinise that first before we get the good news from you. But I'm going to pass to Graham Simpson. He has a couple of questions.
Well, more than a couple, actually, convener. Mr Johnson, do you ever contact stakeholders, i.e. the bodies that are receiving funding from Bord na Gaelic, to see what their relationship is with the board and how that is working?
I know that one of the things that the sponsor team does is maintain relationships with a number of bodies that are in receipt of funding, both from Bord na Gaelic and from the Scottish Government.
So that's a yes, you do contact them?
That's a yes in terms of the work of the sponsor team. It's not something which I do or have done personally.
Right, and because I've heard anecdotally that that relationship between some of the bodies that receive funding and the board is, how shall I phrase this, not what it should be. I won't put it any stronger than that.
So can I respond to that by saying that the 18-19 audit by Deloitte that this committee has considered as I recall, did make clear the need for improvement in terms of the relationship between Bord na Gaelic and its stakeholders. And that's something that's been taken very seriously by the body. I have sought and have received assurance that they are reaching out and are seeking and receiving feedback on their performance and on how it can be improved. Indeed, in my letter to Bord na Gaelic around the time of the audit, I emphasised the need for them to be really proactive in engaging with their stakeholders, in listening carefully to their perspectives and concerns. And certainly, I think the audit, the most recent audit, has confirmed that they have better systems in place for that engagement with key partners.
Okay. Now, when the board was set up, clearly there were a number of targets. I mean, you wouldn't expect it to just receive government money and do nothing with it. I mean, it has to deliver something. So originally we had a set of targets which said that by this year there should be 4,000 entrants in first year Gaelic medium primary education, 65,000 Gaelic speakers recorded in Scotland, and 40,000 Gaelic speakers who can read and write the language. Those were the targets originally for this year. How are we doing against those targets?
I don't have the numbers in front of me as to exactly where we're at with those targets. I am very happy to take that one away and write to the committee if that would be acceptable. I do know that that Bord na Gaelic has been reporting on the progress it's been making against its strategic priorities and against its key performance indicators, and the progress is being made, but it may be that you have got the numbers in front of you. I'm sorry, I don't.
Well, I don't have the numbers. That's why I was asking you, Emma, because it strikes me that if you're putting in several million pounds a year to a body and you're expecting certain results, that, you know, I thought you might have known how they're doing against those targets, but you don't.
Well, what I am in the discussions I have had with Bord na Gaelic and with the sponsor team, I am hearing about significant progress in terms of the use of Gaelic and the greater increase, or the increase, for example, in children who are being educated in Gaelic medium. So we do have an improving situation here, but I will take away the point to be, I will take away and get back to the committee the point that you've raised about specifically where are we at against each of the targets that were originally set.
Okay, I have actually just found the answer to one of those targets, which was a target of 4,000 pupils entering primary one in Gaelic by this year. And in fact, the figure last year was just 653 against a target of 4,000. That doesn't strike me as doing very well. Would you agree?
Well, that would still indicate that we've got a lot further progress to make.
Yes. So what are you doing about it?
That comes back to the both the importance of the work of Bord na Gaelic in seeking to ensure the promotion of Gaelic language. But of course, there's also an important role for our partners in local government, who are the ones who are providing Gaelic medium education. And that's absolutely something that requires continued focus.
Do we know how many Gaelic speakers there are in Scotland?
I don't have the figures in front of me as to the precise numbers of Gaelic speakers at this time.
The ultimate target for 2041, so another, we've got 20 years to go, was for there to be 100,000 Gaelic speakers. I imagine we're nowhere near that, are we? You don't know.
Again, I think we've got some way to go, but I'm sorry, I don't have those numbers in front of me for today.
Right. Okay.
Graham Simpson, any further points?
No, I think Mr. Johnson's unable to answer the questions that I've got, so I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Alex Neil, please.
Hey, thank you, convener. Good morning, Paul. Can I pick up on the point about stakeholders? Because while I recognise that more efforts being made now in terms of scrutiny by Bord na Gaeilge, by the Scottish Government, including improvements into the internal workings of Bord na Gaeilge, what worries me is from the feedback I've had from the Gaelic community, there is a very strong feeling that Bord na Gaeilge isn't speaking for them. And as the sole shareholder in Bord na Gaeilge, I would like to know what the Scottish Government is doing or going to do to find out what and already the end users of Bord na Gaeilge's services think of the performance. I mean, I heard you say that you've asked Bord na Gaeilge to make sure they have more robust engagement with their stakeholders and all the rest of it. But, you know, the shareholder doesn't always take what the board of directors says as gospel. So what's the Scottish Government going to do to reach out to the Gaelic community to ensure that Bord na Gaeilge is doing work on a satisfactory pace and satisfactory quality to their customers, if I can put it that way?
Yes, I understand the point, and there is engagement between Bord na Gaeilge sponsor team and stakeholders, given that there is at some times shared responsibility for funding, and indeed the Deputy First Minister I know has held a number of meetings with Gaelic stakeholders. But I do think that you're raising an important point, and I can see that there is scope, perhaps more formally, for the government to be engaging with key stakeholders to gauge their views on the relationship as of now, given the steps that we've taken to seek to build about improvement. So it's certainly something I would be happy to take away, that there should be an exercise where we are formally contacting stakeholders, obtaining their views on the relationship, and then working together with Bord na Gaeilge to pick up any issues that arise from that.
Well, I think stakeholders are at two levels. There's a formal organisation such as local authorities and others. That's absolutely right that you talk to them. But actually, you know, as a result of the work the Audit Committee did in this last year, I got a lot of feedback, and I think other members did, from just ordinary members of the Gaelic-speaking community, from all over Scotland, by the way, extremely dissatisfied with the role of Bord na Gaeilge. Many of them thought it was just almost a self-appointed little club looking after each other, rather than serving the wider interests of the Gaelic-speaking community. I can't comment if that's true or not, because I'm not a member of the Gaelic-speaking community. And it seems to me that maybe modern techniques used by government to test opinion, in this case amongst the Gaelic-speaking community, as opposed to all the formal stakeholders who have all got their own agendas. But what I'm interested in is, if the money the government is putting in welcome money into Gaelic speaking and Gaelic medium education, is that providing a satisfactory service to the end user? And I mean, I don't know why we don't use modern methods of public opinion surveying and the like, focus groups and the like, to get to these people, the government to get to these people and understand what their concerns are about Bord na Gaeilge, and indeed the wider issues around promoting the Gaelic language.
Yes, I can see that that's an entirely reasonable step that we could take. I take some assurance from the fact that Bord na Gaeilge are reaching out more actively to their stakeholders and can provide us with data around the feedback that they are getting around the impact that Bord na Gaeilge is having. The committee will recall that they have also made real strides in terms of openness and transparency, and it is therefore now much easier for stakeholders and for members of the public to engage with Board na Gaeilge, to hear all that is going on in their board meetings, to raise any issues or concerns directly with them. But none of that negates the fact that I can see the merit in further engagement between the Scottish Government and both formal stakeholders and Gaelic speakers to see what we can do to improve matters further.
A good example of that, Paul, would be, although you couldn't give the up-to-date figure, but we do know that there's roughly 65,000 Gaelic speakers in Scotland. Not entirely concentrated in the Highlands, many of them are in Glasgow. You know, in my own area, we've got an excellent Gaelic medium education facility in Cumbernauld. But if we are going to, if the language is going to live, two things have to happen. First of all, there are wider issues that need to be addressed in terms of housing and Gaelic communities and all the rest of it to retain people and retain the language and retain local schools. But also, we need to get that number up from 65,000 to nearer the original target of 100,000. And I don't see any plan. I don't see anything in what the Scottish Government is saying or doing, or what the board is saying or doing, to get us from that 65,000 to anywhere near 100,000. And I don't see how that's fitting into a wider strategy for regenerating the communities, Gaelic communities, in such a way that, apart from anything else, it's economically sustainable and socially sustainable, but also ensures that the Gaelic language lives on. I don't see any strategy big enough to do that.
Well, sorry, shall I reply to that?
Yes, I please.
Yeah, sorry, the screen just changed.
My last question, Paul, so make it a good answer.
Well, I'm not sure. I hope the best answer is to say that I recognise that we need to be doing that work. So thank you for the point. Forgive me, committee, but I am here specifically focused on the issues around governance between Board na Gaeilge and the Scottish Government. But I accept that these are really important wider issues about the whole strategy for the promotion of Gaelic in Scotland and for meeting the targets that have originally been set. These are matters that I will take away. I will update the committee in terms of where we've got to, but crucially, I think we need to consider very carefully the points that the committee have made in terms of how we can really accelerate progress. I know there is work underway that the DFM has been leading that is seeking to accelerate that progress, and I'll certainly provide an update on that work.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Gail Ross, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Paul Johnson, just to follow on from Alec Neil's point, certainly I've had conversations with people, constituents, schools, one school in particular on the North Coast that are having difficulties recruiting Gaelic teachers. Now, this is not for Gaelic medium, it's just for Gaelic education. So, you know, when we're going for the joined up approach, and as Alec Neil also said, they get a teacher, it's very difficult to get a house for them. So I just wanted to put that on record and also ask, you know, what is the strategy for rural communities in particular? Because what seems to happen is they teach Gaelic to the pupils, they become proficient, they maybe go there for a year and do their either their probation or they stay for a couple of years. And then when they get some teaching experience, they tend to move on to bigger schools and bigger communities. So what can we do to attract teachers to remote rural areas and to keep them there as well?
I think that's an excellent point, and I would like to turn to Graeme Logan as Director of Learning to say a bit more on that point in just a moment. I know there have absolutely, as you recognise, been challenges in terms of attracting and retaining the teachers. But I would also want to say that I think we've seen Gaelic educators lead in some phenomenal ways recently, and actually the eSchool programme that has been piloted in Western Isles, seeking to ensure top quality remote teaching of Gaelic, has now served as a real model for remote learning across Scotland through COVID-19. So I do want to just highlight that real positive. I visited a couple of years ago Western Isles and saw the work of eSchool, not imagining for a moment at that point that actually it would be something that we would seek to take and utilise for learners across Scotland. So I think there's a model there that can continue to be developed, ensuring high quality Gaelic education can reach every young person in Scotland, regardless of where they are located. But maybe Graeme could say a little bit more about the issues you've raised around the teaching profession. Graeme.
Thanks very much, Paul, and good morning, colleagues. Just to respond to you, Ms Ross, I mean, we're certainly acutely aware of the need to pursue a number of routes into teaching for rural communities. So I think we've been working, for example, with the University of Highlands and Islands to have a flexible route into teaching, which enables people to remain in their communities. We know that a big barrier for a lot of citizens was perhaps having to relocate to Aberdeen or Edinburgh or Glasgow to do, for example, the graduate diploma in teaching. So there are alternative routes which enable people to remain in their communities. And we want to continue to promote those opportunities. I think we're also looking for other innovative ways. Paul mentioned the work on faster rates of progress with Gaelic, which is a really important forum where we bring together public bodies and local authorities to try and improve the rate of progress with the Gaelic language. And as a result of that, the General Teaching Council for Scotland have been surveying teachers who are either working in, for example, GME, or would like to move into the sector or learn more Gaelic language. And I believe there's been about 600 respondents from those registered to teach in Scotland to date who would like to do that. And the General Teaching Council is therefore following up with opportunities to learn the language and potentially to move into the sector. So I think the flexible route with the UHI, I think the numbers are quite low. It's roughly about 30 teachers each year through that route, and we're obviously looking to expand that further. And we're acutely aware of those issues that Ms Ross has raised. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Bill Bowman, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Paul, can I ask you about leadership at the board? The CEO told us, I think, in correspondence that they were about to recruit three new board members and was seeking skills in change management, corporate governance, financial scrutiny, strategic planning, as well as corporate communications. And that the closing date was the 18th of December, with the appointments to take effect from the 1st of April this year. So, firstly, can you tell us whether the planned recruitment was successful and if the new appointments take effect from the 1st of April? And what role the Scottish Government had in the appointment of these new members?
So I can confirm that there has been a recruitment round which has been partly successful but not wholly successful. So you'll appreciate that we will set a high standard, maintain a high standard for all board level appointments. My understanding is that we are expecting one new board member to come onto the board very soon. But that some gaps remain, and so there are two things that need to happen. One is there will be a further appointment round, which the Scottish Government will work with Bord na Gaelic to support. And we are also working with Bord na Gaelic on ways in which we can strengthen some of the gaps that they have got in their in their organisation. We are just in receipt of a request, now a formal request from Bord na Gaelic, which gaps that now as to be filled, and we are giving our attention to that because obviously that requires additional funding.
So, do you know why only one of the three has been appointed, what was the, did you have the applications? They weren't suitable, or you didn't get applications?
No, we did get applications. This was one of the actual recruitment, you'll appreciate, was a matter that was taken forward between the chair of Board Nagaelic and with involvement from the sponsor team. And the briefing that I have had since then confirms that while there were a number of applications, you'll appreciate there is a detailed interview process and recruitment process at which all applicants are tested to ensure that they have the required competencies and skills. And in this case, one person has been appointed from that recruitment round.
So who's making the decision? Is it the board itself, or is it the government?
So ultimately it is for ministers to appoint the members of the board. So the a sponsor team member and the chair were on the recruitment panel. That panel comes up with recommendations, and it is ultimately for ministers to make the appointments.
But accepting that you may have some gaps still to fill, is the government now satisfied with the quality of the leadership, both within senior management and the board?
Well, we are determined to maintain high expectations of the board, and as is set out in the framework agreement, there is ongoing close engagement between the director and the deputy director, and that includes an annual appraisal process of the chair and an annual scrutiny of performance. And ultimately, as you, I hope, will hear clearly from the Deloitte auditors, we have seen that real determined work to ensure improvement that has been led by the chair and by the chief executive. I welcome the efforts that they have made. They've shown real determination in responding to the challenges and in securing improvements. And of course, they recognise that must continue. The job is not done. There are still some elements of the improvement plan outstanding, and there is a need to secure continued progress.
But I think I'm looking for something slightly more specific. I mean, are you satisfied or aren't you satisfied?
I am satisfied that good progress
with the quality of the leadership.
I am satisfied that the chair is leading the body with real energy and with determination. Yes.
I mean, I think as Alec Neil said, you are the sole shareholder here. So, if you aren't satisfied, then, who would be? But let me just ask, and how will you monitor this going forward so that we don't actually get into a situation that we were in the past, and that the changes that are being made are actually successful?
Yes, so the new framework document sets out the range of ways in which we will be monitoring progress. So that includes regular meetings between the sponsor team and the executive team in Board Nagaelic. It includes quarterly meetings between the deputy director and the chair. And we are also inserting some extra engagement, and in particular, Graham Logan will now be meeting regularly with the chair to really ensure that there is progress against those key strategic priorities. My expectation, of course, is that all of these actions will be undertaken, and that should there be issues, these will be escalated to the portfolio accountable officer.
Well, just finally then, I mean, that's a sort of an internal process, and picking up on what Gail and Alec were saying, that if your customers, if your stakeholders are not happy, then, the whole thing is not really working. How are you actually going to make sure that you have a direct knowledge of what's happening out in the, I won't call it the marketplace, but out in the field, in the front line?
Yeah, I take that as an important point that's been raised this morning. The sponsor team does have engagement with a range of stakeholders. The Deputy First Minister does have engagement, regular engagement with a range of stakeholders. And as you can see from the correspondence that I have shared, stakeholders can come to us with particular concerns, and we have acted to address them. But I hear the point about the real proactivity of that engagement and the reach beyond particular organisations, and I think that's a very good point and is something that we should ensure happens regularly going forward.
I think proactivity and reach are the key phrases there. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you.
Okay, do members have any further points on the Borden and Gallic report for the panel? Okay, can I thank you both, Graham Logan and Paul Johnson, for your evidence on this report this morning. I'm going to suspend briefly until 9:54 for a brief changeover of witnesses, please. Thank you. Agenda item 3 is the key audit themes, Scottish Government support for public bodies. I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting today, Paul Johnson, Director General, Education, Communities and Justice, Sharon Fairweather, Director of Internal Audit and Assurance, and Katrina McLean, Deputy Director, Public Sector Reform, Public Sector and Third Sector, and the three of them are all from the Scottish Government. And I understand, Paul Johnson, that you'd like to make a brief opening statement, please.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss the action that's been taken by the Scottish Government to improve the engagement between sponsor teams and public bodies. Over the lifetime of this Parliament, a number of audit reports have highlighted the need for strong relationships between public bodies and their sponsor teams in order to ensure good governance and accountability. The public must have confidence that public bodies are operating effectively, focused on their purpose and objectives, spending money wisely, and taking the time to learn and improve. I welcome the recognition from the Auditor General earlier this year, speaking to this committee, that for the most part, the vast majority of the arrangements work effectively, with public bodies delivering what is expected of them and having an appropriate level of support and challenge from their sponsor teams. The Auditor General also stated that the government is taking steps to improve the consistency in sponsorship arrangements. Most bodies are functioning well, including through the enormous challenges that COVID-19 has brought, and I pay tribute to the staff, the board members and the sponsor teams for the work they have done to secure this. However, each report that the committee has considered over this Parliament provides scope for learning and improvement, and I have seen the way in which improvements have been made in each case following the Section 22 reports and the issues highlighted by the committee. I'm joined today by Katrina McLean, who leads the team that is providing support to sponsor teams and public bodies across Scotland. We now hold regular events for all sponsor teams to come together and share learning. The most recent event was in December 2020, where I shared learning from the recent issues that have arisen with Bord na Gaeilge, and we collectively looked at the lessons that had been learned from a previous audit scrutiny. I've spoken directly to every sponsor team at these events. I summarised to around 100 sponsor team leads what I see as vital issues, summarised as 5 C's. Firstly, compliance. The sponsor team must ensure that the legal and operational frameworks are being adhered to. Capacity. It is essential to ensure that sponsor teams have the resources that they need, and in turn, that we support the body in having the resources that it needs. Thirdly, clarity. Governance and accountability arrangements must be set out clearly in a framework agreement which is monitored, reviewed and updated where needed. Fourthly, communication. There must be clear lines of communication between Scottish Government and the sponsored body, including around attendance at board meetings and the frequency and purpose of engagement. And fifthly, and really importantly, culture. It's very important that there is a culture of strong, open and trusting relationships between government and sponsor team. These will enable issues to be identified and resolved at an early stage. Thanks in part to the scrutiny and challenge from this committee, we do now have an enhanced package of support in place for sponsor teams, and further work is in hand to build on this. A short review is now underway to take stock of the particular context we now find ourselves in, learning from COVID, seeking to capture good practice, and ensuring that we are doing all we can to learn the lessons that have been highlighted through this Parliament. I'm keen to look at ways in which we can develop further our early warning systems to ensure the rapid escalation of issues that might arise. I am also keen to support leadership development within our public bodies. Scrutiny and assurance activities, finally, will always have an important role to play alongside the support that we offer. And to that end, I'm joined by Sharon Fairweather, the Government's Director of Internal Audit and Assurance. Sharon will be able to describe the audit activity that has taken place and that is planned alongside the assurance activity that is taking place in relation to IT projects. I'm happy to follow up on any of these matters. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul Johnson. I'm going to ask Graham Simpson to open questioning for the committee, please.
Thank you very much, convener. Thank you, Mr. Johnson. That was a really useful opening statement, and I found it quite encouraging to hear about some of the work you've been doing. Can I just run through some of the reports that you mentioned? Because we have seen a number. There was a report on colleges in 2017, that the Auditor General at that time told the committee the ability to spot problems early and tackle them seems to be very variable. There was a report in 2018-19 of Community Justice Scotland that raised a number of questions about the support that had been provided to the board by the Scottish Government. There was a 2017-18 report of the Scottish Social Services Council that concluded that the Council had not followed good governance or project management in undertaking its digital transformation project. We've heard earlier about Bord na Gaeilge, we know all about that. There was a report on the Scottish Public Pensions Agency that raised a series of concerns about the management of their pensions project. And there was a 2018-19 audit of Disclosure Scotland that raised concerns relating to governance, again, financial reporting and management of a new IT system. And of course, we've had a number of Section 22 reports on NHS boards, in particular NHS Tayside, which we looked at last week. So a number of reports, you mentioned them in your opening statement, but you also said that you're taking measures to tackle these, it seems to me, systemic problems. So I wonder if you could either yourself or one of your team tell us in a bit more detail what exactly has been done to address these issues.
So I will turn in a moment to Katrina McLean, who heads the team that is seeking to ensure that there is support given to all sponsor teams. But before I do so, let me say a little about the specific issues that you have mentioned, because I do think it's important to do so. So every one of those reports, first and foremost, are ones that raise significant issues and ones that have been taken very seriously indeed. In every case, work has been done within the body itself to ensure that improvements take place. And I have sought assurance in the regular course of my role as Portfolio Accountable Officer as to the progress that is being made with each of the bodies. And I've been struck when I have looked at the subsequent audit reports for each of those bodies within the area for which I have responsibility, struck by the way in which significant progress has been noted. I won't go through them all in the interest of time. I know, for example, the committee has looked carefully at the Scottish Police Authority over the years, and I was pleased to see the most recent audit describing progress, improvements in financial management, stability and leadership, progress in relation to audit to organisational governance. Just one more, Community Justice Scotland, which the committee has also considered. Again, the subsequent audit referred to good progress in respect of the agreed actions. So I think it is very clear that where specific issues are raised, swift and determined action is being taken by the bodies, and there is clear oversight of that by the Scottish Government. Nonetheless, we would all much prefer the issues didn't arise in the first place, and that where issues arise, lessons are learned so that they don't arise with other bodies. I fully accept that. That's why we are strengthening the programme of support to sponsor teams, which Katrina can say a little bit more about, with your permission.
Yeah.
Katrina? Oh, sorry. Thank you. and good morning. Yes, as Paul said, you know, it's quite heartening to know that in most cases our public bodies are working well, but we also know there is more to be done, and this is a continuous programme of improvement. It's not a one-off, it's something that we do regularly. In fact, in the last number of years, we've carried out around 40 training events for sponsor teams and for board members. We try, where possible, to pull the learning from what's working well in that sponsor ecosystem and look to see where we can learn from areas where it's not working well, and we build that into our work programme. For example, in this coming year, we're going to be carrying out a number of items, and I think Mr. Johnson provided the committee with an outline of our work plan for this year, which includes sponsorship training. That training will be delivered by David Nicol, who is a well-respected individual who is, has great knowledge of good sponsorship, and it will cover a wide range of things. It will be in two parts. It will cover, in one part, for someone who is new to sponsorship, the roles and responsibilities and an introduction to that, and also what to look out for and how to sponsor well. And then we will also have an advanced programme of for those who are more experienced in sponsorship, which will focus again on scenarios of what might happen when things go wrong, how to escalate it, etc. So we want to cover the wide range of learning that is available to our sponsor teams. And I should just say that these modules and this training has been developed in conjunction with Audit Scotland and with the Standard Commissioner for Scotland. Thank you.
Okay, that's really useful. I know other members will have more specific questions, but I just wonder if I could just another question to Paul Johnson. Is there anyone, it might be you, Mr. Johnson, anyone who's got overall responsibility for sponsorship arrangements across the Scottish Government? Is there one figure?
Well, ultimately, this is a matter that is set out in the Scottish Public Finance Manual. So the provisions of that manual make it clear that ultimately it's for each portfolio accountable officer to be assured that sponsorship arrangements are working effectively in their area. So that's why I have got a particular interest in all of the bodies within the education, communities and justice portfolio. It is my responsibility to delegate to individual directors and deputy directors the duties that they must exercise as sponsor directors. I also happen to have within my area the team that provides support across all of the Scottish Government. That's the team that Katrina leads. But it is a responsibility for individual directors general to be assuring themselves that appropriate sponsor relationships are in place in their area. And then what we have as part of our governance is an annual process whereby each Director General provides assurance or indeed identifies any issues to the Principal Accountable Officer, the Permanent Secretary. Those issues are then highlighted as part of our overall governance framework, and indeed, as the Auditor General mentioned, sponsorship issues have been identified as an overall corporate issue for the Scottish Government, and that is referred to in the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts this year.
Okay, so fair to say there's no one figure, there's a number of you, and so but you all talk to each other.
Yes, we are all members of the Scottish Government's corporate board and Scottish Government's okay. executive team, and we are all reporting to the Principal Accountable Officer, the Permanent Secretary. We're all given our responsibilities from the Permanent Secretary and in turn required to give an account to the Permanent Secretary of the way in which those responsibilities are being discharged.
Okay, thanks very much. That's me, Convener. Thank you.
Alex Neil, please.
Yeah. It would be helpful, Paul, if we could get a list. I realise you can't provide this detail this morning,
but it'd be useful for us to get a list of all the sponsoring departments in the Scottish Government and how much the budget is for running this each sponsoring department. Because it seems to me, in some cases, it is quite, if you add it all up together, it's quite a substantial overhead. And, you know, I remember many years ago, the late Professor John P. McIntosh wrote a book arguing that too many functions of government even then were carried out by agencies that are much more difficult to hold to account from a parliamentary point of view. And his argument was some functions are far better done in-house, where you don't need a sponsoring department, it's just done by the, in this case, the Scottish Government. So I think getting an overview of the list of sponsoring departments across the Scottish Government and how much each costs would give us an indication just how important in terms of the public resources being used up in this function. Because I think at some point a future audit committee might want to look at this in more detail.
Yes, I can see that that's an important point. You'll appreciate that. Well, I shared with the committee some pretty basic information. Apologies if it's material that you were already well cited on, but I thought it may be helpful just to provide that overview of what the public body landscape looks like. And of course, we're working within the framework of the legislation agreed by Parliament in relation to many of these bodies, which set out their status and their relationship with the Scottish Government. I can take away that request. I have looked fairly recently, and I know that sponsor teams will vary in size and seniority. In some cases, there will be one person. In some cases, there will be a small team. The one important qualification I would add is that sometimes the sponsor team will have quite a range of responsibilities as well as sponsoring a particular body. So I would just have to add that qualification if we're actually providing you with overall numbers. But as I say, I'm happy to take it away, and I appreciate that this is an important function of government. And there are more than 100 bodies set out in the overall public body landscape. And so there is significant resource that goes into this sponsorship function.
Yeah, that would be very helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Colin Beattie,
thank you,
please.
Convener.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to explore a little bit around some of the detail of how the sponsor system actually works on the ground. For example, a very obvious one is, how do sponsor figures actually gather intelligence? I looked at you at what you produced for the Board na Gaelic, and I wonder, do they actually physically attend all the board meetings? Do they have a risk register for these organisations with checklists of the type of things they should be looking for? Does that exist?
So the starting point is to look at the framework document, and there is, as we described in the earlier session, there is a model framework document that is not prescriptive around issues such as attendance at board meetings. It is something that needs to be agreed between the Scottish Government and the sponsored body, and will depend in many cases on the issues that are being dealt with by the body. So, for example, on Board na Gaelic, mindful of the issues that have been raised in the audit report, the up-to-date framework agreement makes clear that the Scottish Government will be attending all board meetings as an observer, and also sets out the range of engagements that will take place with a regular rhythm between the sponsor team, the deputy director and the director, and Board na Gaelic. There will be other bodies where, as a matter of course, the Scottish Government is attending the board meetings. There will be others where it is not. But in every case, I would look to the framework document to be setting out the terms of engagement between the Scottish Government and the body in question. There are some, for example, in my area where I have attended board meetings on an annual basis rather than attending every meeting. That's all to be set out in the, as I say, the terms of engagement between the Scottish Government and the body.
Now, what about, do they have, Colin, they must have some...
Sorry, Katrina McLean would like to come in on this point, if you'd like to hear her.
Sure,
Katrina?
Of course.
Yes, just to build on what Mr. Johnson said there about, you know, attendance at board meetings, but also you asked the question about risk registers. What we do have in our guidance is, and is provided to the sponsors team, is a risk profile, which is completed and covers all sorts of different elements of a body, from finance to engagement to relationships, etc. And the sponsor team complete that risk profile. Sometimes they do that themselves, but we encourage that to be done along with the body so that there's a joint understanding of that risk profile. Thank you.
So would the sponsor figure have, for example, would it be an alarm bell if there was a lack of challenge by board members, which is an issue that this committee has seen on a number of occasions? Would that be something that would create an alarm?
That would be certainly something in terms of the risk profile that we would want to identify as an area of concern or something that would need to be discussed.
Okay. I mean, the sponsor figures are the eyes and ears of the Scottish Government. How do you make sure they're doing their job? How do you make sure that they're actually doing all the things they should do?
I can pick that one up. So ultimately, that gets into the good management and leadership of people in the organisation. Every member of staff, whether part of a sponsor team or discharging some other responsibility, should have very clear objectives set, should be having a monthly conversation at least with their line manager, and a regular process of performance reviews. If a member of staff has got sponsor responsibilities within their role, then the effect of discharge will be discussed regularly with the line manager. So it's through good line management. That is the principal way in which these matters are dealt with. The specific responsibilities of sponsor teams are set out in the framework documents that govern the relationships between each sponsor team and the sponsored body.
I mean, clearly it's really important that there's an appropriate distance kept between the public body and the sponsor team. Obviously, you don't want one official to be too long on the job and supporting that one body, because it can lead to issues. How do you make sure that these sponsor figures don't become too close to the sponsored public body? Is there a system of rotation, for example? How does that work?
There is not any formal system of rotation, although most civil servants do move role from time to time. And indeed, sometimes I think the criticism has been that there is at times too much movement. So there's a balance to be struck here, I think. There is a benefit in civil servants building up a real knowledge of the body and a real understanding of its purpose and of the issues that it's dealing with, and indeed of the stakeholders that it works with. And there is at times a tension, because you will recall, I'm sure, that at times we faced the charge of being too distant from the body, and at other times we can be accused of being too close to the body. And that's not to trivialise the issue. What I'm saying is it's really important that we work to get the balance right in terms of the distance from the body. What we must do in all cases is respect the statutory frameworks within the body, within which the body operates. That will generally include being very clear that it is the chief executive of the body that is the accountable officer. It is the chair of the body that has got statutory responsibility for its oversight. And indeed, as has been clear from this committee's scrutiny, it's the chief executive that will be directly held to account for the performance of the body.
So what would you consider to be a reasonable time period that as a sponsor figure would be attached to that body? 2 years, 3 years, 4 years?
I don't really think it's possible to be prescriptive about how long an individual should be working as a sponsor lead. I think it does depend on, in some cases, on the particular skills that the individual brings. But I would say it is pretty common. It is commonplace for staff to move to different roles or to take on new responsibilities every few years in the Scottish Government.
Okay. You've said already that for sponsor figures they get all sorts of training and so on in the lead up. Do they do scenario training? I mean, we've got so many things that have come forward to this committee, scenarios that we wouldn't want to see happen again. Do you use these in the training?
Yes. We absolutely do. I think sometimes those real life scenarios are the most useful things. It really helps to bring the training alive. And indeed, in the recent events that we have held for all sponsor leads, where, as I mentioned, at times we've had over 100 sponsor leads in attendance, we've actually used the live scenarios that have been raised through the audit report and that have been considered by this committee. And we've invited the sponsor teams and at times members of the body to come and describe the learning that they have taken from the issues. And certainly the feedback that I have had is that that's sometimes been the most effective and the most compelling way for other sponsor teams to really recognise the importance of grasping the issues that have been raised in other audit reports and the issues that have been raised by this committee, and ensuring that that learning is then taken into the sponsor relationship that the particular team has with their body. Absolutely vital that it's real scenario-based learning. I should also say that in a number of those sessions, we have invited Audit Scotland to participate, so we have the benefit of their perspective, and also the benefit of perspective from internal audits.
Just one final question in relation to the function or how sponsor figures operate. Are they briefed to maintain regular contact with staff at all levels? Because what we've seen in previous scenarios is that a great deal of the intelligence that they'd be gathering could come from staff who frequently know a great deal about what's happening that maybe the board doesn't, if I can put it like that.
Yeah, typically engagement will take place between the board and between staff in the body. It will depend on the size of the body and on the range of connections. So, for example, if I think about the Scottish Police Authority, a body that I've worked quite closely with, there are a number of colleagues in the sponsor team there who are working with quite a number of staff in the body. So there'll be a lead on finance in regular contact. There might be a lead on strategy in regular contact. So there'll be a number of links into the body, particularly in the case of the larger bodies. If the point is around kind of gauging the views of staff more generally at all levels in the organisation, that's not something that a sponsor team would typically do. We would expect to see the results of the annual staff surveys that all bodies should be carrying out, and they should serve as quite an important indicator of the overall well-being of staff in the organisation, and serve to highlight any particular issues or concerns.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, Bill Bowman, please.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Good morning again, Paul. You maybe covered a little bit in the broad-ranging discussion before, but could I ask you, in terms of the individual undertaking a sponsorship role, what would be the sort of typical grade? Is there a minimum grade of that person? And what are the key skills you look for in that individual? And are there enough people willing to do this role? And is it something you're appointed to or you're asked to do? Are you a volunteer or is it just you're told to do it?
So there should always be senior civil service oversight of the sponsorship arrangement. That's something which we expect as part of the the guidance that we provide to sponsor teams. So that would be a deputy director or a director, ensuring strategic oversight. They would then, typically the deputy director, would then be responsible for forming the team that works to them and that provides the day-to-day engagement with the body. The grades of those team members will vary depending on the size of the body. So typically a range of grades below the senior civil service. I am not aware of any issues in attracting and recruiting members of staff who wish to serve as sponsor team members. I actually think it's a very rewarding, satisfying role, getting a real perspective as to what some of our public bodies are doing and how they are delivering and contributing to the delivery of important outcomes. So certainly there are no issues there. You may be aware that when we do advertise roles externally for policy functions in the Scottish Government, we have huge demand for those roles. So no particular issues there. And as I think I mentioned earlier, it really then comes down to the line manager specifying really clearly the duties of the postholder in their objectives, ensuring that the postholder has access to support, advice and training. And that is what is coordinated by Katrina's team. And then ensuring monitoring of their performance through our performance management systems.
Is the deputy director what we would call a sponsor figure, who then has a team?
Yes, we would call them the overall sponsor lead, I think is the correct term.
So the one we're talking about, how many years in role, etc., would relate to that individual?
Yes, and certainly deputy directors will typically move role every few years. So they would be the overall, I would say, the overall strategic lead for sponsorship, and they will, they will have a small team working with them.
I think you said earlier that each portfolio accountable officer has the responsibility for the sponsorship role within that area. Is there a commonality of skills and roles of the sponsoring figure? You don't set up your own determination of what a sponsoring figure should be. It would be the same throughout all the portfolios.
Paul, before you start, Katrina McLean would like to come in. Katrina, can I bring you in, please?
Yes, I was just going to build on what Mr. Johnson said, and it might actually go some way to answer the question that's just been asked. The sponsor role should be similar across the whole of the organisation, and one of the ways that we are considering to strengthen this position is by creating a sponsorship as a specialism course where people can undertake this and then get recognition for the skill set that they have developed, which should help again to create a consistent approach to sponsorship across the organisation. Now, we're at early days in thinking about this, and it has to be tested. That idea has to be tested within the organisation, but it's something that we think would be of an advantage to try and improve and build on the good practice that is, but actually give recognition to that good practice. Thank you.
Well, Katrina, if I could just stick with you for the moment then. I mean, that seems to make sense and to have a consistency. I think you mentioned earlier to do with the training, somebody called Mr. Nicol, was that right?
That's correct, yes.
Who is that person and what are they going to do?
So as I said to you, the person's name is David Nicol, and he is a director in onboard training, which is a recognised organisation that provides high quality training for board members and for the type of sponsor arrangements that we have. And what we are doing at the moment with him and others is developing a training course which will be delivered not just once but over a number of ways through all the sponsor teams within the Scottish Government. Hopefully within the next month to 2 months we will have those courses in place and invite our sponsor teams to participate.
that's
and as I said, yes, he's an external, yes, but someone with that, you know, detailed experience, both of providing support to boards and dealing with some of the issues that arise when bodies have difficulties.
So if I can follow that, and it may be you or Paul that would answer, but how do you monitor the performance of a sponsor figure, see that they're actually doing their role effectively? Is there some form of appraisal which assesses their specific performance as a sponsor figure?
So again, that should form part of an individual's general appraisal. But again, it's something that we recognise we could strengthen, and we want to check in with internal audit to see if there is a way of actually codifying that more and having a process in place where we can actually monitor it more effectively over the piece. But in each individual sponsor team, they will be monitored during their performance, and that will be reported to the portfolio accountable officer as part of that process.
So just as a final point then to Paul, that sounds like the sponsor figures perhaps not actually being assessed or appraised on their sponsoring activities against you know, whatever the role definition is. And I agree that it's good that you might do it, but is it not being done at the moment?
Well, there is the system that Katrina McLean has described does work effectively, in my view, and is taken incredibly seriously. That is the regular monitoring of performance. And if one of your duties is sponsor team leader or sponsor team member, then it's absolutely to be expected that your performance in relation to that duty will be monitored as part of your performance management. Mm-hmm. But I accept there is always scope for us to learn and improve, and I welcome the work that Katrina McLean's team is taking forward, which is exploring whether we should be strengthening this further. So yes, with training modules, undoubtedly, but potentially also with quite a robust annual accreditation exercise, so that we're recognising the importance of all sponsor teams keeping their knowledge and skills up to date and making sure that they are learning the lessons that are coming out of the scrutiny of this committee and the important work of both internal audit and the work of our external auditors.
Thanks. I think appraisal is always good for the employee and the employer. So thank you, and thanks, convener.
Okay, are there any further questions from members for the panel, please? Okay, can I thank you all, Paul, Katrina and Sharon, very much for your evidence this morning. I now close the public session of this meeting as we move into private. Thank you very much.